We want to trust you while you're in this establishment. My establishment. This is a good Borstal. Progressive. We put great store in trust. So if you three lads play ball with us, we'll play ball with you.
Smith! Shut up and stand to attention.
We want hard, honest work, and we want good athletes. And if you give us both these things, we'll do right by you and send you back into the world as honest young men. Any questions? Take them out, Mr. Roach.
Sir.
The Loneliness of the Long Distance Runner by Alan Sillitoe. Dramatized for radio by Robert Rigby.
Running has always been made much of in our family. Especially running away from the police. You might think it's a bit rare, having a long-distance cross-country runner in Borstal. Thinking the first thing a cross-country runner would do when they set him loose is to run away from the place as far and as fast as he could. But you'd be wrong, and I'll tell you why. The first thing is that them bastards over us aren't as daft as they look, and the second thing is neither am I.
Making a break for it and getting caught? That's a monk's game, and I'm not falling for it.
Cunning is what counts in this life. And even then, you've got to use it in the slyest way you can. I'm telling you, them lot, they're cunning. But I'm cunning too. If only them and us had the same ideas, we'd get on like house on fire. But they don't see eye to eye with us, and we don't see eye to eye with them. So, that's how it stands.
And that's how it always will stand.
Check them bags.
I'm not pushing Oreo.
Give it a rest, the lot of you. Go and try your new clothes on.
Oh, get indoors and stop moaning.
And mind them bags. And one of you, put the kettle on. There we are, Duck. Keep the change.
Oh, thanks very much.
Ah, then.
See ya. Size of that tip, you must reckon you made a money.
I am. And I don't hear you complaining, dolled up in your new suit.
Are we going in or not?
There's no worry, is there?
Oh, I get it. Want the neighbours to see your coat, eh, ma'am?
And what's wrong with that?
No, I suppose. But I want some grub. These bags are heavy and I'm starving.
Never bloody satisfied, you.
Maybelline, why can't you be true? Oh, Maybelline, why can't you be true? You done started back doing the thing you used to do.
I
knew
not one of them put the kettle on. Now you'll have to get your own tea. Lionel's coming round. I have to get ready. And don't look at me like that. Lionel's been good to me since your father died.
Oh, I know that, ma'am. I noticed.
Dream.
Smith, come on, Smith, wake up. Come on, then, up you get. It's time for your run. Don't wake all them other sleeping beauties.
Yeah, all right.
Sir.
It's a treat being a long-distance runner out in the world by yourself on a frosty morning. Not a soul to make you bad-tempered or tell you what to do, or that there's a shop to break and enter in the next street. I'm 17 now and I think I've never been so free as when I'm doing my 5 miles. Turning at lanes or footpaths without knowing I'm turning. Leaping brooks without knowing they're there. I've been doing a lot of thinking since coming here, especially when I'm running. thinking and then writing it down on these scraps of paper when I get back. A light were running. It passes the time away and it don't make Borstal seem half so bad as the boys in our street said it were.
Oh, they told me it were when I was in remand homes before.
But I'll tell you now, I haven't finished making all my false moves yet. And I dare say I won't until I kick the bucket. Don't give in to those coppers and Borstal bosses and bastard-faced in-law types like the governor. That's what I say. Spouting on to outlaw blokes like me about honesty and how he'll help me if I win him the All-England Borstal Cup for long-distance cross-country running. What blokes like the governor will never understand is that I am honest.
And that I've never been anything else but honest. That I'll always be honest.
Sounds funny, but it's true, because I know what honest means according to me, and he only knows what it means according to him.
Telly's nice. Wanna go watch it?
No, I'm just saying, it's nice. 21-inch screen, your mum says.
She's hardly seen it. Who's the rest of us sat in there with an ham sandwich and a bar of chocolate while she's upstairs testing out the springs of a new bed with some fancy man?
Hey, I could do a sandwich myself.
500 quid she got for me dad's insurance from the factory. For our bereavement, they said. 500 quid.
It's a lot of money.
It were. Most of it's gone now. Clothes and tellies and a brand new carpet because the old one were covered with blood from dad's dying and wouldn't wash out.
Should we have a sandwich then?
I've been bone idle for 2 months, Mike.
I know.
But what's the point in sweating your guts out on a milling machine when there's a wad of crisp blueback fivers waiting to be spent?
Suppose we could go watch the telly.
We'll go out.
What for? It's foggy out again. A right piece of soup, or?
I'm fed up with telly and adverts for them things I can't afford no more.
Morning, Mr. Bishop.
Good morning, sir.
Got them hard handed, I see.
Yes, sir. Door and window blames for the new building.
Excellent. Very industrious. Hard work and honest endeavour, eh?
They'd rather be out in the air, sir. So would I come to that. But we're getting on with these frames so that when we can get outside...
Is Smith with you?
He's over there, sir, at the bench.
Ah, yes. Mind if I have a quick word with him?
Of course, sir. Smith! Over here, lad. The governor wants a word.
Yes, sir.
All right, Smith?
Yes, thanks, sir.
How's the running coming along?
Very good, thank you, sir.
Mr. Roach tells me you can get round that circuit faster than anyone we've had here before.
Yeah, I like to run, sir.
And getting faster by the day. Approaching peak condition, eh?
I'll set myself to trot round the grounds after dinner, sir, just to keep me hand in.
Good. Excellent. Hard work and honest endeavour. That's the attitude, eh, Mr. Bishop?
Oh, yes, sir. Very good.
Yes, indeed. Exactly what we want from all our lads. You're setting a fine example, Smith. And I know you'll win us that cup.
I will do my best, sir.
Bloody fog, it messed up my glasses.
I wondered why you keep walking into me.
It gets in your throat, too.
Should put a scarf over your mouth.
I can hardly see front of houses.
It's cold. Should have got my man to buy me an overcoat before all the dough went. I'll get myself a coat if it's the last thing I do.
And I'll get some new glasses. Gold rims instead of these white frames. Hey, what's that like?
Fish and chip shop. Can't you smell salt and vinegar?
I can, even with the door closed. Should we have some?
We haven't got 2 halfpennies between us, Mike.
Well, I said we should have had a sandwich.
Keep your eyes on the ground for lost wallets or out. I
had these glasses from school. I've always hated them.
Hey, hang on.
What?
The baker's yard. There's a window open upstairs. You see it?
No.
I saw it in the car headlamps. Come on, quick, while there's no one about. Do you see? Up there?
I do.
just waiting, inviting us in.
Yeah, but how do we get in?
Over the wall. Your shoulders will take my weight easy. I'll go over, then open the gate for you.
Can you reach up there?
I'll reach all right from your shoulders.
There's broken glass on top, I can see it.
I'll use me jacket. Bloody good job I didn't get a new coat. You ready?
Right, tread in me hands first, then on me shoulders. That with me here.
Sorry.
Mind the glass on top.
It's mostly worn down. Been here years by the look of it. Here I go, then.
You all right? Smith? Are you all...
I came. I broke. I entered. I'm in Essex. I never even knew where Essex was till they sent me here. And while I run, I've been asking myself all sorts of questions and thinking about my life up till now, and I know this.
I'm not a bloody racehorse.
I'm a human being. And I've got thoughts and secrets inside me that the governor and all the pot-bellied in-laws don't even know are there. Because they're stupid. I suppose you'll laugh at me saying the governor's a stupid bastard, but what I say is true enough. He's probably read 1,000 books and, for all I know, written a few. But what I scribble down with my stub of pencil is worth 1,000,000 of what he could ever write down. Because I know when he talks to me and I stare into his mug that I'm alive and that he's dead. At the moment, it's dead blokes like him as have the whip hand over blokes like me. And I'm almost sure it'll always be like that. But I'd rather be like I am.
I was on the run, breaking into shops for a packet of fags and a jar of jam, and have the whip hand over somebody else and be dead from the toes up.
Maybe, as soon as you get the whip hand over somebody, you do go dead. That last sentence has taken a few 100 miles of long distance running to find.
Want every copper in Nottingham turning up. Strike another match.
I've only got 3 left.
Bloody good burglar you are.
Over there. That little lamp on desk. Put it on floor and switch it on.
Can we risk it?
We'll have to if we're going to find out. That's better. I'll try the desk, you check the cabinet. Keep quiet, will you?
It's a nice typewriter. Must be worth a bob or two. Shall we take it?
And how are we meant to carry a bloody typewriter down a drainpipe?
It just seems a shame to leave it.
No, this is what we want.
Is it locked?
Of course it's locked. No point in keeping cash in a cash box if you don't lock it. Let's go.
But we ain't looked everywhere. There might be more cash.
No, it's all in this. Has to be. Come on.
What about that typewriter?
Leave the bloody typewriter. You can't write any road. And turn the light off. I can't write much about what Borstal is like because I haven't got the hang of describing buildings or saying how many chairs or slatted windows make a room. And to tell you the truth, Borstal hasn't really hurt me at all. And Borstal doesn't get my back up neither, because my back's always been up right from when I was born. It's a good job I write all this down when I get back, otherwise I'd have dropped the whole thing weeks ago. because they can spy on us all day to see if we're pulling our puddings or if we're working good or doing our athletics. But they can't make an x-ray of our guts to find out what we're telling ourselves.
Or what we're thinking.
You decided to come back to us then?
Oh yes, sir. Couldn't stay away. Proper home from home, eh, Smith?
Something like that, sir.
Governor's little golden boy, aren't you?
I wouldn't say that, sir, not exactly.
No? Well, I wouldn't want to be in your shoes if you don't win him that bloody cup.
I can only do my best, sir. Governor knows that.
Cheeky little son. £75, £76, £7, £8 and £10. That's 15 bob and fourpence halfpenny.
Lucky for us that baker didn't put his cash in the bank.
Ah, but then he wouldn't have given a couple of honest, hard-working blokes like me and you a chance.
What are you going to do with yours?
No, not yet any roads. And neither are you.
But what about your overcoat? And my glasses?
If we start splashing the money about, people will think we've latched onto something that don't belong to us. And there's some round here who would love to do the coppers a good turn.
But I hate these glasses. I've had them since...
And you'll have to keep them a bit longer. There's a bloke down the street broke into a factory a few months back. And the first thing he did was buy himself a teddy boy suit and a set of skiffle drums. Coppers picked him up before he even got indoors with him.
Then what do we do with all the cash?
We take the bobs and the tanners and the pennies for now. But the notes... Come with me. And stay quiet. Don't wake me, ma'am. She'd steal from her own, she would.
Where are we going?
Only to the back door.
What?
Shh.
Where now?
Nowhere. But these notes are going up this drain pipe. We'll keep doggo for a week or two, and then we'll take a few quid a week till it's all gone. There. Safe as the Bank of England.
Nobody would think of looking up a drainpipe.
You're right, Mike. We might be thieving bastards, but we're not green. Sometimes I'm the greatest warrior in the world, as you might have twigged from me having got this story out and written it down. It's funny though, because me mam don't know the meaning of the word worry, so I don't take after her. But me dad had an hard time of worry all his life. Right up to when he filled his bedroom with hot blood and kicked the bucket that morning. Cancer of the throat. I'll never forget it, straight I won't, because I were the one that found him and I often wish I hadn't. Mam led him a rotten life ever since I can remember.
Knocking on with other men even when he was alive and fit.
And not caring whether he knew it or not. Most of the time he wasn't so blind as she thought, and he cursed and roared and threatened to punch her tab, and I had to stand up and stop him even though I knew she deserved it. But I still think of the outlaw death my dad died after telling the doctors to scat from the house when they wanted him in hospital like a bleeding guinea pig. He got up in bed to throw them out and even followed them down the stairs in his shirt, though he was no more than skin and stick. It's not till now that I know what guts he had.
Not till now.
Is he coming down or what?
You heard me call him when I went up. He was spark out.
It's 11 o'clock.
I'm his mother, not his keeper.
He's not working, then?
Ask him yourself. Don't expect me to do your dirty work.
Oh, we'll ask him. You could ask me in, Mrs. Smith.
I could, but I've got the neighbours to think of, and my reputation.
Thanks very much.
You know we all ate your guts, so why should I be nice to you?
Morning. My mum said you wanted a word.
I do. Can you tell me what you were doing last Friday night?
Last Friday? I'm not sure.
He was here. He's never left that television set for the last 3 months, so you've nigh on him, mate.
You know where Papa Wick Street is, don't you?
Is it off Alfreton Road?
You know there's a baker's halfway down on the left-hand side.
Is it next door to a pub?
No, it bloody well ain't.
You might as well look for somebody else, mate, because you're wasting the rates you get out of my rent and the income tax that comes out of my wages.
Where were you last Friday night?
Do you mean, was it at the baker's you mentioned, or the pub next door?
You'll get 5 years in Borstal if you don't give me a straight answer.
I was glued to the telly like me mum told you.
I told you you were.
I know you did. Have you even got a television?
Has the aerial fell down? Or would you like to come in and see for yourself?
He's not setting foot in my house. Look, you've brought the neighbours out now. You'll have the old street standing gawking before long. Had a good eyeful, have you? Nosy buggers.
We know you weren't watching television last Friday, and so do you.
I've got witnesses. Man for one, a fancy man for two. Ain't that enough?
No, it ain't.
Well, I can get you 13 if it were a baker's that got robbed.
I don't want no lies, Smith. Just tell me where you put that money.
But I don't know what you're on about.
And if you want to search this house, you'll have to fetch a warrant. I know my rights.
Do you think it's safe for us to be seen together?
Bloody hell, Mike, we're not Britain's most wanted.
But that copper said he's certain we did it.
The owlers say that. Just trying to put the frights up you.
They are. How do you think they know it were us?
They don't know. They think, that's all. As much as coppers can think.
But why'd they think it's us then?
They know I did a high wall job before. And that's what I went in remand home for. Second time. And all the local cops know you and me are best pals, so they're putting you through the same mill as me. Guessing. But they don't know nothing. Look, that baker's is at least a mile from where we live. Not a soul saw us, what with the fog, and we weren't more than 5 minutes in there. We did a clean job, and we're in the clear. So just keep your mouth shut.
Your mum's not happy.
You didn't tell her?
No, but she...
And she'll back you up, won't she?
I suppose. Look, that copper over there. I think he's watching us.
He's watching the bloody traffic. But if you keep looking at him, you'll make him suspicious and he will watch us.
I was thinking, maybe we should take the cash and do a bunk.
What?
Somewhere on the coast. Skegness or Cleethorpes. We could stay in the boarding house, have a good time in the arcades before they catch us and get sent down. I love that penny football.
Look, you daft bleeder, we ain't gonna get caught. And we'll have a good time in Skegness, but later, when it's safe...
That copper is watching us. I'm sure he is.
Oh, come on. I'll take you to the pictures.
It's a bloody disgrace. Upsetting my house and my family like this. Treating my son like he's a criminal.
He wanted a warrant. I got one.
It's intimidation. Mm. That's what it is, man. Trying to get me to confess to something I didn't do.
Listen, my lad, I don't need much more of your lip, because if I get you down the Guildhall, you'll get a few bruises and black eyes for your trouble.
Did you hear that, man? That were a threat.
Too right, I heard. Bloody coppers. We don't live in a police state yet, you know. Oh, that's right. Smash me ass up as well.
That vase is worth money.
It's an antique.
It's priceless.
An heirloom.
It's been in the family for years.
Be careful with the valuables, Constable.
Sorry, sir.
You'll be sorry, all right. I'll bloody sue you. And I'll write to me MP. And mind me aspidistra. That's taken years to grow like that. It were me mother's.
That's an heirloom too, is it?
Oh, very funny.
Leave the plant, Constable.
Right.
If you tell me where the money is, we can stop all this. And I'll get you off with probation.
What money?
You know what money, you thieving young bastard. We'll teach you to steal money that don't belong to you.
Mum, get my lawyer on the blower, will you?
Oh, it's a good job my young'uns are at school. You'd frighten them to death, you would.
You think you're so clever, don't you?
Do I?
But I won't rest until I get this cleared up. I'll get you. I promise you that. I'll turn this place upside down if I have to.
Keep your eyes on them, man. Watch they don't pocket nothing.
I bloody well will. And mind me bedroom carpet! It's new!
And where did the money for that come from, I wonder?
From me dad. He bloody died for that carpet.
And then the young copper, he put his head up the chimney like the detective sergeant told him.
Maybe he were looking for Father Christmas.
So he come down looking like Al Jolson.
Had to swill himself clean in the sink.
He shouldn't have let him.
I took pity. He weren't quite so bad, the young one. Cup of tea, Lionel.
Now, Duck, I'll wait till we get to the pub. So, did you take it?
Take what?
The money. Did you break into that baker's?
Lionel?
I'm just asking.
My mum hasn't asked me if I did it, so why should you?
Interested, that's all. Quite a lot of money, apparently.
And how do you know that? You know the job yourself, were you?
Don't be daft, course I weren't.
I'll do me face and we'll go, Lionel.
Or is it that you want a cut of the proceeds to keep your mouth shut? Lionel.
Oh, so you did do it?
No, I bloody didn't.
Don't argue, the two of you. We've had enough rowing today, what with that copper.
That daft mate of yours, Mike, was he in on it too?
Lionel, will you stop it?
Join the police now, have you, Lionel?
He looked scared stiff when I saw him, were you?
Did he?
Like a rabbit in a searchlight.
Well, he always looks that way. It's them specs he wears.
If it were me, I wouldn't depend on that one for an alibi.
And I wouldn't depend on you for out. And neither should me mam. You've helped to get through most of me dad's death benefit, so I suppose you'll disappear once it's all gone.
You cheeky young bastard!
And when I want advice from me mam's fancy man, I'll ask for it.
I told you to stop rowing, didn't I?
He did it all right.
It's you. Don't you ever give up.
No, I don't.
Well, I won't ask you to come in out of the rain.
You've been identified.
Oh, have I?
A woman saw you and your mate yesterday, and she swears blind that you're the same two chaps she saw going into that bakery.
That's funny, because I didn't even see my mate yesterday.
She saw you. She swears it.
Then she's a menace to innocent people, because the only bakery I've been in lately is the one up our street to get some cut bread on tick for Mam.
Where is your Mam?
She went to work, but she wouldn't invite you in either.
We got a witness. A reliable witness. Now all I need to know is, where's the money?
I think Mam took it to work with her to get a cup of tea in the canteen.
I'll ask you one more time, Smith. Where's the money? What the... What?
Oh, bloody hell.
It's a fiver. Soaked through and the ink running, but it's a fiver. Oh, and look at this. Oh, it's a pound note. And surprise, surprise, here's another fiver. And another. All rolled up and stuck up the bloody drain pipe.
I wonder how they got there.
Oh, I wonder. There's nothing like a drop of rain, is there, Smith? Washes away all the dirt and the grime and the rubbish. Cleanses everything. I told you I didn't give up, didn't I? I told you I'd get you. You're nicked, lad.
Oh, well, clear!
And it's raining. Rain in my heart.
He's one of mine, young Rawlings.
Yes, very good. I should think they'll go higher, though. Quite a bit higher. That's one of my lads up next.
The grounds are looking colourful.
Did you see the tulips on the driveway?
Yes, I did.
Mrs. Lennox loves flowers. You should see our garden. It's a treat, eh, Celia?
Considering it's in the grounds of a Borstal, yes. One does one's best.
Your lads had the bar down.
Bad luck.
Good effort, then.
Yes, I remember your delightful garden from last year.
When Gunthorpe retained the overall trophy and the long-distance cross-country cup, the Blue Ribbon event, wouldn't you say?
Indeed I would. And we're aiming to give you a run for your money for it this time.
Could we have the runners for the full 40 yards over the start, please? Runners for the full 40 yards.
Pity about the drizzle. Still, a good day for running, though.
I don't seem to see many parents.
It's the boys. Few of them bother to write home.
We have the same problem. So you've got a good one, have you?
Good one?
Long-distance runner?
Oh, yes. Smith. He's very special. A genuine talent. I spotted him soon after he arrived. Saw the potential almost instantly.
Well, he won't have it all his own way, I can promise you that. I've a very good lad, and I hear Hucknall fancy their chances too.
They'll be off after the 440 yards. I think I'll give that a miss and go in and wish Smith, well, all of them, the very best of luck.
I'll come with you.
I'd like some tea.
The VIP refreshment tent is just over there, Mrs. Lennox.
We'll join you there.
If you can find the time.
My wife's not the sporting type.
Really?
You've never actually won the long distance cup, have you?
Some of the boys were saying we ought to include javelin and discus in the championships this year. A little too much in the way of temptation, did you think? Here we are. Ah, there's my man Roach. Everything all right, Roach?
Yes, sir. All going according to plan and on schedule.
This is Mr. Lennox, the governor of Gunthorpe.
How do you do, sir? Your boy has been telling me he fancies his chances in the big race.
He's a good lad, and he's worked hard for today. Been in strict training.
Ah, and here's our young favourite. Feeling in top form, Smith?
Yes, thank you, sir. I'm looking forward to the race.
And you're probably warmed up and ready to go.
Yes, sir. I've had a little trot round to stretch my legs.
We don't want any pulled muscles, do we? He might take up running in a sort of professional way when he gets out.
That good, is he?
We think so. How would that suit you then, Smith, my lad?
It'd suit me fine, sir.
Good show.
He's got to win this race before he thinks about turning professional. He'll have to go some to beat my boy, and there's always a couple of dark horses in the field.
We're not horses, none of us.
What was that, Smith?
I said there's a lot of good runners, sir.
Yes, yes indeed. And we're taking nothing for granted, are we? May the best man win and all that.
I'll grab a quick word with my lad.
And warn him about the competition, no doubt. Win that cup for us today, Smith, and I'll get you trained so that you can whack every man in the free world.
Thank you, sir.
Well, good luck. We've worked hard for this, Smith. Don't let me down.
Right, runners for the long distance cross-country event, make your way out to the starting line, please.
Don't get left at the start, Smith.
Oh, no, Mr. Roach. I won't.
Although, I dare say you'd catch him up if you were.
And now here come the runners for the big race, the long distance cross-country event.
What's all them empty seats over there?
It's where the mums and dads should be.
So why ain't they come?
Would you come to Borstal if you didn't have to?
No, I suppose not.
No, we've got all them bloody lords and ladies strutting about and drinking tea in that posh VIP tent over there. I hope they find time to watch me.
You're confident, eh?
Right, come on, lads. Come on, quick as you can. One long line, please. Behind the line. You lad, number 32. I said behind the line. Come on, quickly now, settle down. Right, here we go then. On your marks.
Thanks. He's off at a good pace. It's like the charge towards the first fence at the Grand National.
They go down the long straight, once around the field, and then out into the country. It's a testing course.
And no doubt your lad knows it like the back of his hand.
He knows it, certainly.
Home advantage.
As your boys had last year. But Smith doesn't need home advantage.
And the course is clearly marked. No risk of visiting runners heading off in the wrong direction.
Mr. Roach?
Sir.
Would you care to explain to Mr. Lennox how the course is marked?
Marked, sir?
There's no need. I was just asking.
No, I insist, for the sake of absolute fairness. Mr. Roach, Please describe how you've marked the course.
There's really no need.
I insist, Mr. Roach.
Right, sir. Well, there are splashes of whitewash on gateposts and tree trunks, sir, and on stiles and stones. The whole 5 miles is very easy to follow. I did it myself.
That sounds fair.
Exactly as it should be.
We have a boy standing by with water and a bandage box every half mile. And there are members of staff dotted around the course, too, for security. No one will get lost, sir, unless they choose to.
So I fancy we can rest easy and join your good lady for a cup of tea. Don't you, Mr. Lennox?
If you ever want tips about running, never be in a hurry. And never let the other runners know you're in a hurry, even if you are. You can always overtake on long distance running without letting the others smell the hurry in you.
Who's in a man? Where you gonna run to? All on that day.
Use your craft to reach the two or three up front, and then you can make a big dash later that puts everybody else's hurry in the shade. Because you see, I never race at all, I just run. And somehow I know that if I forget I'm racing and only jog trot until I don't know I'm running, I can allers win a race. When I see I'm getting near the end of the course by recognising a stile or a cottage corner, I put on a spurt. And such a fast, big spurt it is, because I feel that up till then I haven't been running and that I've used up no energy at all. I can do all this because I'm thinking, allers thinking as I run. I sometimes wonder if I'm the only runner with this system of forgetting I'm running because I'm too busy thinking.
I'm sorry, Smith. My mum says I have to do it.
Yeah, it's all right, Mike. I don't blame you.
I'm not supposed to come near you, but I slipped out. I had to tell you.
I appreciate it, Mike. I really do.
My sister told me, Mum, that if I say you led me into it, I'll get off with probation.
Yeah, and he's right. Makes sense, so that's what you have to do. Don't worry about me, I'll be all right.
It's a shame we didn't make it to the coast, eh, Smith? Penny football in the arcades. Shame it had to rain so that copper found our cash.
It could have been on our trail a lot sooner.
Could it?
I buried the cash box under me mam's aspidistra. That bastard copper was sniffing round it for long enough, but he never caught on. And Mum hasn't seemed to notice that the aspidistra's not prospering like it used to.
You don't mind, then, about me saying you led me into it?
Of course I don't mind. We're pals, aren't we?
Legs lifting and falling. Arms going back and forward. Lungs hardly working at all. When the governor talked about me being honest when I first came into Borstal, he didn't know what the word meant, or he wouldn't have had me racing in shimmy and shorts and sunshine.
Water. Here, this water is
coming. No.
Well, keep going, Smith. There's only two in front of you.
I know.
If the governor knew what honest meant, he'd have had me where I'd have him if I were in his place. In a quarry, breaking rocks until he broke his back. He don't know the meaning of honest, none of his gang do. At least that plainclothes copper was honest. He had it in for me and I had it in for him, and we both knew it. That were honest. And he had it in for me man when my case were coming up in court. That were the finest bit of spite I've ever heard of. But I would still call it honest too.
Going on?
It's a police, Mrs. Smith. Detective Sergeant asked me to give you an early call.
Early? It's bloody 4 o'clock in the morning.
Is it? I were passing on the beat.
You'll have all my kids up. I can hear them now. You've woken them.
What's all the racket?
No!
I'm meant to be in court this morning.
That's why I'm here.
Who is it?
Sergeant wanted me to remind you, Mrs. Smith, you have to be in court with your lad dead on 9:30.
She bloody knows.
I bloody know.
Are you coming back to bed or what?
It's the police, Lionel.
I know it's the bloody police.
Is it time to get up?
See, I told you. You've woke me kids.
Sorry about that, Mrs. Smith.
Mum, who is it?
Go back to bed. It's early.
We'll have the whole family in a minute. They might as well make us a cup of tea now.
The sergeant just wanted me to remind you, that's all. Wanted to help.
That bloody bastard copper.
A bastard. But an honest bastard. He knew what he were doing and he'd done for me good and proper when he stood up in court to give his evidence. Made me out a right villain. Mike were all right, though. I was glad that Mike got away with it, and I only hope he allers will.
Not like silly bastard me.
This was your first offence, and when you eventually made a full and frank confession, you further assisted the police by revealing the whereabouts of the missing cash box. You have admitted the error of your ways, and have today shown admirable contrition. You will therefore be placed on probation for 1 year, and I trust that at the end of this period of observation and supervision, you will have learned your lesson, and will never again be drawn into criminal ways.
Not like silly bastard me.
You, on the other hand, Smith, are already a hardened criminal with a string of previous offences leading to spells in remand homes. But you refuse to learn your lesson by leading a worthwhile and honest life. You are the brains behind this crime. You are a menace to honest lads, and you have shown no contrition whatsoever. I have no hesitation, therefore, in sending you to Borstal.
Flip-flap, flip-flap, jog-trot, jog-trot, crunch-slap, crunch-slap. Across broad fields, into dark woods and splashing through streams. Run, run, run. When I see another runner ahead of me, I know there's nothing he can do to stop me passing him. Having the time of my life, loving my progress, trot, trotting. A steady rhythm, hardly trying, not even making haste, just running smooth and...
Come on, pal, keep up!
Hardly breaking sweat. Moving away further and further, knowing I've won the race long before it's over. Running like I come from a long line of whippets trained to run on two legs. I could go on for 10 or 15 or 20 miles and drop dead at the finish of it, which would be the same in the end as living the sort of honest life the governor wants me to. Running.
On me own. Not seeing anybody.
So quiet. And even less noise and movement than there had been at 5 o'clock of a frosty winter morning. Then, I first knew what the loneliness of the long-distance runner felt like. Running across the country. Realising that as far as I was concerned, this feeling is the only honesty and realness in the whole world. Going into that last mile and a half like a knife through margarine. But the quietness, so quiet and clear, like opening my eyes underwater and looking at the pebbles on the bottom of a stream, suddenly reminded me of going back to the house that morning when my old man had croaked.
Hello? Man? Man? Man, are you up there? Dad? 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 You asleep, Dad? Dad? Oh, Dad. Oh.
Dad.
He had guts, my dad. When I went in the room that morning, he was lying on his stomach with the clothes thrown back, looking like a skinned rabbit, his grey head resting just on the edge of the bed. And on the floor must have been all the blood he'd had in his body, right from his toenails up. Nearly all the lino and carpet were covered in it, thin and pink. I hadn't thought about it much since it happened, and even then I didn't brood on it. But since I started to think on this long distance running, I'm liable to have anything crop up. And now I see my bloody dad on every blade of grass. And now I'm bloody crying. And crying is the thing I haven't done since I were a kid of 2 or 3. When the governor told me to be honest, it was meant to be in his way, not mine. And if I kept on being honest in the way he wanted, he'd see I got the cushiest 6 months I've still got left to do. But in my own way, that's not allowed. I have to win my race, all right, but win it my way. With guts. With honesty. I hope the governor's got all his Popeye gang placing bets on me. 100 to 1 to win. All the money in their pockets. All their wages for the next 5 years.
And I try to instill in my boys a philosophy of honesty and hard work, coupled with athletic endeavour. Will you excuse me? That must be the leading runners.
Yes, of course.
Just one lad. Is it Smith?
Pretty sure it is, sir.
It's Smith. I'd know his long, lanky legs anywhere. I knew it. I knew he could do it.
Are you certain it's him? I can't see from here. Where are my binoculars, Celia?
Around your neck.
I'd know my own man. I'd recognise Smith a mile off.
Oh, yes. It's him, all right.
But he looks done in.
And there's still a fair way to go.
Once around the field and then up the long straight to the finish. Same as the start, sir, but in reverse.
Thank you. I gathered that.
May I use those binoculars?
Be my guest.
He looks perfectly fine. Bit red in the face, that's all. And wouldn't you be after 5 miles? And he's way ahead. There's no sign of another runner. He can walk it from there. Is everything set up for the presentation, Mr. Roach? I knew you'd get me that trophy.
Of course, sir. Everything's ready.
I suppose Smith should collect the cup himself. Or perhaps it should be me, on behalf of the Borstal.
Whatever you think best, sir.
He's slowing down.
What?
Look for yourself. Your boy, Smith, he's slowing down. No, he's taking a breather, that's all. Pacing himself. Clever running. Tactics.
I don't know about tactics. Maybe he's blown up. Maybe he can't run anymore.
He doesn't want to win too emphatically. Make it look too easy. Sportsmanship's important. I always tell them that. Play the game. Be a good sport.
Taking part is as important as winning, you mean?
Exactly. He's... What the bloody hell is he doing? Roach!
I don't know, sir. I've never seen him like this. He can normally go on for hours.
Smith! Come on, Smith! Run!
He can't hear you. And there's my lad, Compton, just coming into the field. Go on, Compton! You can still catch him! You can do it!
Smith! Come on, Smith!
Go on, Compton!
Roach! Will you please get that bloody man to shut up?
Them watching haven't caught on yet to what's happening. Cheering like mad for when I cross the line.
But they can see me slowing down. Especially the governor and his gang in the grandstand. Bloody hell, I'm going so slow I'm almost marking time, but I won't cross that finish line. Not even if I have to sit down cross-legged on the grass and the governor and his chinless wonders pick me up and carry me across. Which is against their rules. So you can bet they'd never do it because they're not clever enough to break the rules.
Smith! Run with you! Run! He's catching you!
Come on, Compton!
You can still do it, man! Do it for Gunpool!
I don't wish to ruin your day, Governor, but it appears to me that your runner is deliberately slowing down.
No, that's impossible. I think my wife's right. He's in no trouble at all. He's just slowing down or almost walking now. No, that's impossible. But he's in the finishing straight. He's got it won. There's less than 100 yards to go. Come on, Smith!
Come on, Smith!
Your friends are shouting for you. Do it for your friends. Do it for your Borstal. Smith!
I'll show the governor and all his pot-bellied mates what honesty means if it's the last thing I do. Though I'm sure they'll never understand, because if they did it, it'd mean they'd be on my side, which is impossible. I'll stick this out like my dad stuck out his pain and kick them doctors down the stairs.
If he had the guts for that, I've got the guts to go no further than this.
He stopped. He stopped running.
He's not even walking. He's standing still. He's got no intention of winning that cup for you.
But he can't do that.
Oh, yes, he can. He wants to lose the race.
How perfectly curious.
Mr. Roach! Where are you, Roach?
I'm a cross-country runner. But the only time I'll cross that finish line will be when I'm dead and a comfortable coffin's been got ready on the other side.
In a way, you have to admire his guts.
Do you?
He's waiting for my lad to pass him. Looks like we'll keep the cup after all, Celia.
He seems to be looking directly at us.
And the little bastard. He's smiling.
No, Governor. He isn't smiling. He's crying.
I'm a long distance runner. Running my race, my way. No matter how bad it feels. And I'm blubbing like a baby. But out of gladness that I've gotten beat. At last. Bloody hell, you took your time, mate. It looks shagged out. Keep going. You're nearly there!
I cried a river over you. I cried a river over you.
Don't think I'm not still running, because I am. One way or another. The governor proved me right. He didn't respect my honesty at all, not that I expected him to. And I didn't try to explain it to him, because if he's supposed to be educated, he should have more or less twigged it. He's got his own back, though, or he thinks he has, because he has me carting full dustbins from the kitchen every morning. Then he gets me shifting tons of manure and slops to the bottom of the garden where I have to empty them out and spread them on the carrots and spuds. It's not a bad life, I can take it. Work don't break me. If anything, it makes me stronger. I'm a long-distance runner, and I always win in the end. In the meantime, as they say in one or two books I've had the chance to read in here, I'm going to give this story I've written to a pal of mine, So if I do get captured again by the coppers, you can try and get it put in a book or something like that.
Smith! Bloody hell, do you think you're doing standing there leaning on your bleeding shop?
Sorry, sir.
What do you think this is, an holiday camp?
No, I was just thinking, Mr. Roach.
Thinking? Well, you should have thought before, Smith. It's too late for bloody thinking now. Now shift that muck. And get a move on. I don't want to be out here in the rain all day.
Yes, sir.
Come on, move it!
I am, sir. I'm going as fast as I can, sir. Honest.
That was The Loneliness of the Long Distance Runner by Alan Sillitoe, dramatised by Robert Rigby.